try, the more I fall. I finally see the writing on the wall. The problem lives in what I see. A separate him outside, a separate me. In a desert land.
I've entitled this little series this weekend that I'm sharing anyway, The House of Christian Contrasts. And this is on the title page of your handout. And we noted that in Christian thought and human thought in general, there are contrasts. We looked at the either-ors, and that which Brian and Sylvia just shared from 1 John. If there's any book in the New Testament that is the epistle that deals with the either-ors, it's the first epistle of John. You have the contrast of life and death and darkness and light, good and evil. Great book of either-ors. What we're doing here is noting that there are either or contrasts. There's God or Satan, good or evil. There are also both and contrasts. And then at the top we have a triangle, and this is a whole different category than the other two. We noted at the conclusion last evening that we could sort of draw a line right across there. And, as Sylvia said, pop up into a new dimension. because that is a new dimension. This is the category of thought processes. This is the category of experiential processes. Soren Kierkegaard, and Brian mentioned that in the last session, that he wrote a series of two books called Either Or. Either Or. Now his Either Or was a reaction to the philosopher Hegel that he had studied under. And Hegel and Kant were part of the avalanche of the Enlightenment movement. The Enlightenment movement was the movement that emphasized human rationality, that issued forth in what we call scientific method. Everything is figured out cerebrally, in the mind. So when Soren Kierkegaard wrote his double volume work, Either Or, he wasn't talking about what we have addressed as either or. He was reacting to Hegel and saying, this is the thought area. It's either that or it's the experience level. And Kierkegaard dealt almost entirely with this level of truth. In fact, he just said, truth is subjective. Truth is not figured out with the mind, according to Kierkegaard. Truth is subjective, experiential. And in fact, Sylvia said that earlier in this conference, that if you're going to get to the really real, you have to get to the experiential. You have to go beyond mere thought processes. But before we get here, I want to lead into it by looking at another both and. We looked last evening at the fact that Jesus was God and man. We could have drawn another both and. We could have looked at the being and the doing of Jesus. Who he was, what he did. And when we say that Jesus is God and man. That's his being. He is both God and man. He is the God-man. But how did he live the life that he lived? How did Jesus live the life that he lived? As God-man. You see, it's not all that... Well, it is. It's an absolute paradox that he is both God and man. And if we can accept that, then we have to accept another truth. How did he live the life that he lived? We might be able to accept that he was both God and man, but you can't behave as both God and man at the same time. The function of God and the function of man appear to be mutually antithetical. God is independent, autonomous, self-generating, does everything that he does out of his own being. That's how God works, right? Self-generated expression of his own being, his own character. Man, on the other hand, how does he function? He's dependent, derivative, contingent, and receptive. He's a faith creature. Well, Jesus comes as the God-man. How did he live the life that he lived? Well, the scriptural explanation, we would have to turn to Philippians chapter 2. And it says, although he existed in the form of God, fully God, he did not regard equality with God. Well, I'm in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 to 8, if you wanted to turn there. Although he existed in the form of God, fully divine, he did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped or held on to. But emptied himself, taking the form of a bond servant. That's a functional, right? A bond servant functions in a subordinated way. He takes the form of a bond servant, being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, and he humbled himself. That's a functional attitude, isn't it? By becoming obedient, that's functional subordination, to the point of death, even death on a cross. He emptied himself. What did the Son of God empty himself of? Did he empty himself of being God? No. He could still say, I and the Father are one. Did he empty himself of divine glory? No. The Word became flesh and we beheld his glory. Did he empty himself of the omni attributes? Omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent? No. He did not empty himself of any aspect of being God. See, in theology, they deal with all what they call the kenotic theories, because the word emptied is the word kenosis in the Greek. And so they've argued for centuries about what did he empty himself of. Well, whatever he emptied himself it was not of any aspect of his deity. But functionally, he emptied himself of the right and prerogative to function as God in order to identify with us as man, and therefore lived as a man who is dependent. He lived as a man dependent upon the Father for everything he did and said for 33 years in time. Dependent, receptive, contingent, deriving from the Father. You see, everything God does, He wills it, wills to do it, doesn't he? Wills to express himself as he is. That's why I said last evening, only God has free will. In the absolute sense. That he can determine to do that which is consistent with himself, and he has the self-empowerment to self-actuate that which he has self-determined to do. That's free will. What did Jesus say? I came not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Not my will, but thine be done. God does everything by his own initiative, right? He self-initiates his own action. And yet Jesus keeps saying, especially throughout the Gospel of John, I do nothing of my own initiative. Now God does everything of his own initiative. Jesus comes and says, I do nothing of my own initiative. What I say, it's what the Father says. What I do is what the Father does. The Father abiding in me does his works. John 14:10. What a powerful verse. John 14:10. The Father abiding in me does his works. And then Jesus could say, I've accomplished the works that he sent me to do. And some people say, well, Jesus did wonders and signs and miracles. He must have done that because he was God. Really? Now there's one mediator between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus. The man, Christ Jesus. And then when Peter stands up, the first sermon of the church, there on Pentecost, and he says, Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with signs and miracles and wonders which God performed through him. Which God performed through him. As a man. And God can do miracles and signs and wonders through you if he wants to, can he? Sure he can. You see, what we've just done is we've preempted this cop-out that is so prevalent in Christian circles, where Christian people say, well, Jesus, he could live like he lived because he was God. But me, I'm just human. I mean, I can't be expected to live that way. I'm just human. No, see, you've missed out on two things. He was God, grant you that, but he wasn't just God. He was a man who let the Father act and speak in him for every moment in time for 33 years. And we now, as Christ ones, being partakers of the divine nature, have the same divine provision in us that he had as man. And as he allowed the Father to manifest himself in Jesus the man, we have the very presence of the Lord Jesus Christ in us to manifest himself as our life. So we can't accept that cop-out that Jesus could do what he did, but me, I'm just human. How did Jesus live the life that he lived? By faith. By the receptivity of the activity of the Father in the man for every moment in time for 33 years. That's how he lived it. By faith. Let's go on. We talked about who he is and how he functioned. But there's another observation we need to make about the life of Jesus as we read it of him in the Gospels. And that's the experiential process by which he lived the life that he lived. And what I want to point out is that I've already taken that one off. Jesus lived the life that he lived via the diakinetic process. What?
He
Oh, he never said that. Those are Fowlerian words. Let me read an article I wrote a while back. Goes like this. If anyone was going to craft, construct, initiate, found, or make up a man-made religion, they would never make up the story that's at the heart of the Christian gospel. It is antithetical to all themes of good triumph stories and of all admired religions. The hero of the story is born in a smelly stable to a young mother who got pregnant under suspicious circumstances. The hero flees with his family to Egypt to avoid the genocidal death edict of a paranoid king. The hero grows up in a small, marginalized, maligned village out of the limelight. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? The hero receives a minimalist education, probably homeschooled or trained in the synagogue, but never attended any well-known school. The hero spends approximately 90% of his life as an obscure carpenter up in the hill country. The hero begins to come out into the public at age 30 by submitting to a baptism of a doomsday preacher, wearing a camel hair coat and eating locusts and honey. The hero gathers around him a ragtag team comprised of several Galilean fishermen, a hated tax collector, and at least one zealot with a political agenda to oust the Roman occupiers. Now the hero could draw a crowd, but at the end of every speech, they would all leave disappointed that he'd not met their expectations. And all he had left was the dirty dozen. The hero associated with socially unacceptable outcasts like prostitutes, tax collectors, lepers, gluttons, and drunkards. The hero made his entrance into Jerusalem on a borrowed jackass, not as a victor on a white stallion. The hero was betrayed by the treasurer of his own group, sold out for 30 pieces of silver. The hero endured silently and stoically an unjust kangaroo court where he was falsely indicted for conspiracy to replace the Roman king. The hero was put to death as a common criminal, crucified on a Roman execution instrument and then speared in the side to confirm his death. And the report is that he reappeared after 3 days and disappeared 50 days later. Is that the way you would have written the story? He's an anti-hero, right? He's an anti-hero. You see, any man-made story would have a litany of glorified details about the hero, putting him into the best light possible. But that's not the way God wrote the story. He was obedient unto death, even death on a cross. That backdoor reverse, contrary to natural thinking, counterintuitive message is at the heart of the Christian gospel. It's unnatural, totally unnatural. That's why the natural man can't understand spiritual things when it comes to the Christian gospel. 180 degrees opposite of the natural world way of thinking. Of course, God said that back in Isaiah, right? My ways are not your ways. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. His ways are, in one sense, past finding out, but in another sense, made known and self-revealed. You see, the world says if you want to go up, you start climbing. But in Christian thought, the way up is down. The way to be exalted is to be humbled. The way to gain is to lose. The way to increase is to decrease. The way to be rich is to be poor. The way to invest is to divest. The way to see glory is to suffer. The way to be strong is to be weak. The way to be wise is to be foolish. The way to live is to die. The way to enlarge is to reduce. The way to be useful is to be useless. The way out is through. The way to proceed is to reseed. The way to win is to admit defeat. The way to conquer is to surrender. The way to succeed is to fail. The way to stand is to fall. The way to everything is to accept nothingness. The way to work is to rest. The way to get is to give. The way to lead is to serve. And the way to heaven is through hell.
Amen.
Now that's opposite. That is totally opposite of how the world thinks. You see, in the ways of God, out of the negative comes the positive. Out of death comes life. Out of humiliation comes exaltation. Out of sorrow comes joy. Out of despair comes hope. Out of distress comes enlargement. Out of the unknown comes the known. Out of the crisis comes comfort. Out of the loneliness comes fellowship. Out of the sacrifice comes significance. Out of the deficit comes abundance. And out of blindness comes sight. That's the flow of Christian reality on the experiential level. It always moves from sin to forgiveness, from defeat to victory, from alienation to reconciliation, failure to triumph, rejection to acceptance, foolishness to wisdom. Remember what diakinetic means. It's not Dianetics. I must emphasize that once again. Diakinetic means you move through something to something. You're moving through this to that. And we just saw a whole sequence of those, didn't we? A whole sequence. And Jesus certainly participated. Actually, God's been telling us that this is his way from the very beginning, to move through Adam to Christ, from the fall to restoration, from sin to forgiveness, from spiritual death to spiritual life, from the promise to the fulfillment, from law to grace, from old to new. That God's been illustrating that throughout the history of human existence. And we saw that in the life of Jesus, from manger to Messiah, from obscurity to the foremost, from suffering. He learned of suffering through the things, learned obedience through the things that he suffered. From humiliation to exaltation, crucifixion, resurrection, death, life. Tempted in all ways as we are, yet without sin. Can identify with our weaknesses. He lived in that same diakinetic process that moved through humiliation to exaltation, through death to life. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. My joy will be with you. Crucified and risen. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, that's a scandal to the Jews. We preach Christ crucified, a scandal to the Jews, and foolishness to the Greeks. Right? But the foolishness of God is higher than the wisdom of man. Now, should we be surprised if God's been illustrating that throughout the entire Old Covenant history? Should we be surprised that since that was the process that Jesus went through experientially, should we be surprised that that is the process of Christian life? No, God didn't change the paradigm. We move through this to that. Or as Sylvia said, she used different words. Through the negative to the positive. Right? Through the negative to the positive. We only participate in that diakinetic process because we've experienced an unfathomable inclusion. When he died, he took our death, that we might have his life. And when he died, we died. Jim was pointing that out in his illustrations yesterday. There's this unfathomable inclusion on an objective level that Jesus was our representative. He was the vicarious sacrifice, and we were in him. When he died, we died. We were crucified with Christ. We were buried with him. I mean, we all know Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. Right? Now, this is still the objective level of that. These are what are sometimes called identification truths. Right? Co-crucified, co-buried, co-resurrected, co-ascended, co-reigning with him. We were in him. And then it becomes subjective. Not only was there the unfathomable inclusion of the fact that we were included in him, but there is the unfathomable inclusion that on the subjective level, the experiential level, we are now in him. From the time that we're regenerated, from the time that we receive his life, resurrection life, we are in him. And he is in us. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature, right? And he, Christ, is in us. Paul says this is the mystery, Colossians chapter 1. Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's not the hope of glory. That's not the hope of going to heaven someday. That's the expectation of the glorious manifestation of his very being, life, and character in us right now. Right now. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Do you not recognize, Paul tells, asks the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 13:5, do you not recognize that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless you believed in vain. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. Galatians 2:20. And we are joined in one spirit with him. Union. Spiritual union with Jesus Christ, where he becomes our life. If any man is joined to the Lord, he's one spirit with him. 1 Corinthians 6:17. That's where Norman Grubb was the vessel of God to teach the Christian community union with Christ. Without a doubt. Without a doubt. Union with Christ. The unfathomable inclusion that we're in Him and He's in us and we are united. His life is our life. And it's only on that basis that we then enter into that experiential process that we're talking about. Now let me just, one word here. It is possible to get stuck at the point of the unfathomable inclusion. It's possible to think, I've arrived. I am He and He is me. And you begin to focus on that sense of identity and focus on that oneness, and you sort of go off into orbit in some kind of monistic pantheism that never allows for a Dianetic process. You're just got stuck right there. I am He and He is me. And I'm there. Not. You see, the unfathomable inclusion is for the purpose of being engaged in the process. There are those who've wanted to camp out right there. They get enamored with union life or exchanged life, etc. Emphasizing their identity. I am righteous. I am perfect. Everything I do is Jesus. Watch out. They don't really want to hear anything about this. They don't want to hear about suffering. They want to hear about weakness. They think they've already arrived. Don't get stuck. Yes, we become what He is and who He is, and He becomes who we are. But it's for the purpose of living out that life. As you received Christ Jesus, so walk in Him. Colossians 2:6. Okay. As I was saying, Soren Kierkegaard talked about the either or. And the either was the thought categories versus the experiential category. But we want to talk about what I'm going to call the capstone of the Christian gospel. The capstone of the Christian gospel. That's why it's a triangle and the others are rectangles. Because this is the analytical, this is the experiential. These are the thought processes. These are the life processes. This is reasoned thought. This is practical living. And many of you who've heard me over the years, you have a tendency to say, well, yeah, that Jim Fowler, when he talks different than the rest of the speakers. Why? Because they're usually addressing you right here. In the experiential arena. I mean, you just listen to Brian, for example. Brian Coatney. Everything he says is up here. And it's deep. And it's personal. And he's lived it. And I know Fran and Jenny have a ministry called Deep Waters. Right? And they're talking... they're talking to Christian people about this process. I can remember back in 1973, when as an unregenerate pastor, I got on my knees in the pastor's study, challenged by three other pastors who indicated I didn't know anything about spiritual things, and I didn't. And I was gloriously regenerated on my knees in the pastor's study. And I began to listen to many tapes, and they talked about the higher life, and the deeper life, and the exchange life, and the grace life, and union life. And they had all different kinds of explanations of this experiential process. And I learned. But I knew what God was calling me to. I knew He was calling me to lay foundation for a legitimate understanding of the experiential process. Not that I don't teach this. I talk about Christ at work in you, union life, union with Christ, spirit union allows for soul rest, right? Those are some of the books on the table. But if you don't have a foundation, if you don't have the infrastructure, you go askew at the top. Can you see that? Oh. Your capstone ends up in mysticism, emotionalism, sensationalism, union life monism. That never gets to the real process. You see it? That's what I'm warning you against. I don't want you to have this skewed Gnostic idea. I'm going to confess something to you. When I first began to think about this house of contrast, and I just say right up front, it's just a diagram. And if it's not a tool that works for you, then God's going to bring you one that works, that brings it to your mind, okay? But this was a tool that began to form in my mind back in February. And I'm going to confess to you that when I first began to develop it, it only had two rectangles. It didn't have a triangle on the top. Because I'd been reading Kierkegaard, spend a lot of time in Kierkegaard, and he kept talking about the subjective dialectic and the inverted dialectic and the existential dialectic, and then others talked about the Kierkegaardian dialectic, and so I was keeping everything in the realm of the dialectic, and then I realized, no, as Sylvia said, it has to pop up into a new dimension. It has to go into that diakinetic process of movement, of process. You see, Soren Kierkegaard says, life is only understood backwards, but it's only lived forwards. You see? He was talking about that process of... Paul talked about it in Philippians. Not that I've already arrived, or I'm already perfect, but I press on in the upward call of God in Christ Jesus, right? That's the process. And so I soon realized that that had to be a separate part of the illustration. So what are the this's? Somebody said, I don't like this and that. That seems to be rather impersonal. And like I say, you could call it negative to positive, although the this's aren't always negative. You can have this's that aren't necessarily negatives, although they turn out to be negatives anyway. I'm thinking of a woman whose husband ran off with another woman, and she... was awarded $14.6 million in the divorce settlement. And you say, well, that doesn't sound like a negative. Her this doesn't sound like a negative. But it was. It was. You see, even in situations like that, where you win the lottery, there's all kinds of temptations, all kinds of trials that come with it. The this's are the experiences of life. The experiences of life. You don't even have to search them out. They just come. You know, the Bible uses a word, New Testament uses a word, peirasmos. And it's usually translated trials. And it's the basis of the word is to pierce in order to examine. To pierce in order to examine. Like you stick the toothpick in the cake, you pierce it in order to examine. Well, the word trials is also translated tests, and it's also translated temptation. And in modern Greek, if you were to translate it to English, it's translated experiences. This happens, okay? Stuff happens. I know. It happens. I had someone challenge me recently. They said, Jim, you keep talking about understanding. And I said, yes, I do talk a lot about understanding, but there's another level of understanding. And that level of understanding is standing under. To stand under. To submit, to yield to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. There's several under words in the scriptures. Obedience. Hupakuo. To listen under. Obedience has nothing to do with keeping rules and regulations. That's old covenant. New covenant obedience is to listen under. To stand under. What is endurance and perseverance? It's the Greek word abide under. Abide under. Now, we likened that little red line across there to the fact that Dan Stone used to have above the line and below the line, right? There were times when Dan Stone's line was that you need to get out of the thought processes and into the living, right? There were other times when Dan's line went right across here from the appearances of the this's to realizing the invisible of the that, right? Interesting that Soren Kierkegaard's leap of faith, he does the same thing. There are times when Kierkegaard talks about the leap of faith from the thought categories to the experience categories, but there's also, he uses that same leap of faith in those experiential movement from sorrow to joy, from death to life. So it's interesting that Dan Stone's line was quite similar to Soren Kierkegaard's leap of faith. Isn't it?
Yes.
It really is. What did Paul say? That I might know him and the power of his resurrection. See, that was the that. This is the that. That I might know him. And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. Right? Not that I've already arrived, where I'm already perfect, but I press on in the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. See it? The process of the Christian life. It's the movement of the Spirit. You know, religion gets all caught up as to what is the movement of the Spirit. And I say the movement of the Spirit is this movement, diakinetic, that's through the movement, the movement from this to that. That's the real movement of the Spirit. The manifestation of the fruit of the Spirit in the midst of the situations of life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and the godly control of the self. I don't even call it self-control anymore. It's the godly control of the self. That's the fruit of the Spirit. And there are times when you don't know what's going on. When you're involved in the this's of life, and you think, what is happening? Abraham. God told him to take his son, the one that was promised, and take him up on a mountain and sacrifice him. What's God doing? How? What's he going to do? How's he going to do this? Why? We're often asking why, right? And he took him, not knowing what God was going to do and not knowing how God was going to do it, but knowing that God's ways are always right. St. John of the Cross wrote a classic, The Dark Night of the Soul. Sylvia, Treasures of Darkness. There are times when we are in the midst of those experiences of life that we're in the dark about what God is doing. We're in the dark. That's the dark night of the soul. And we may never understand why. The psalmist says it's not for us to understand why, as long as God is in it. And our response should be to keep our eyes on Jesus. You see, that, the summit, the pinnacle of it, is always Jesus. It all started with God. Remember, in the beginning, God. It all ends with Jesus. The Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, right? That's God's objective. It's all in Christ. It's all that He might be glorified by the Christ expression in our lives. That's the epitome, the pinnacle, the summit. Keep your eyes on Jesus. You may not know what's going on. What a process that is. From death to life. Darkness to light, from the horrible to the holy, from the lousy to the lovely, from obstacles to opportunities, from difficulties to delights, from adversity to adventure, from bondage to liberty, from burden to blessing, from rejection to acceptance, from the low place to the mountaintop, from the valley of despair to the summit of delight, from the useless to the useful, from subordination to authority, from I can't, but He can. From the unpleasant to the pleasing of God. From guilt to no condemnation. From sorrow to consolation. From intense individualism to recognizing the necessity of community in the body of Christ. Now you see, there are radio preachers out there who are going to tell you that if you're having problems, you're out of fellowship. You're not where God wants you. And I say, don't listen to them. You're probably right where God wants you.
That's right.
Because legitimate ministry is crisis ministry. And it's in the midst of our distress that God meets us with His grace. See, God doesn't have any problems. You know what a problem is? It comes from the words proballo, problem. Means to throw down in front of you. God throws down things in front of us so that we can recognize His sufficiency in the midst of it. That's what it is. Thrown down in front of us. And you see, the world sees the appearances and the things that are thrown in front of us as obstacles. And by faith, we see them as opportunities. The world sees these as tragedies, and we see them as trajectories. The world calls them catastrophes, and we call them catapults. The trials become tests to examine whether we'll see Him.
Amen.
That's what it is. Remember Joseph? You remember Joseph? Sold off by his brothers into slavery, falsely accused, imprisoned. And eventually, his brothers come over seeking grain because now Joseph is the agriculture minister of Egypt. And he says, "You meant it for evil. You meant it for evil. God meant it for good. God meant it for good." Wow. And what is? How does the world look at that? The world says that is complete insanity. That is illogical. That is an incomprehensible absurdity. Counterintuitive. Unnatural. You see, they're always trying to build this utopian peace whereby nobody has any problems. And we all get along. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. This process that we're talking about is just the process of sanctification. It's growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, 2 Peter 3:18. By the word for sanctification is hagiasmos in the Greek. Any Greek word that ends in osmos is a process. It's not as if, bing, you're there. It's always in the process. Goodbye, notes.
You don't need them.
I don't need them. I agree. One more thing here. When you're engaged in this process, and you think that in a particular or a specific situation, you've reached the summit. Jesus took a couple of his disciples up on top of the summit once, right? And they wanted to build some tabernacles up there, right? Don't try to build any tabernacles at the top, okay? Because God's going to send you right back here. Because God's for others. And if for no other reason, He's going to send you back there for others to assist them in the diakonetic process, to encourage them. So we don't want to camp out. You can't camp out at the summit. But neither do you want to hang around here in defeatism, do you? We're not talking about triumphalism or defeatism. We're talking about being engaged in the process, whereby God is doing what He wants to do in our lives so that we see Him and glorify Him in all things. Okay. What you hear about when you come to this conference, year after year, is this process. That's what you've heard about if you've been here all weekend. It started off with Scott Pierce. And he talked about the obstacles of pipes under the kitchen sink and lost screws. But you see them as opportunities, right? Who stepped up next? Sylvia. She talked about the storms of life. Used Jesus on the lake. Peace, be still. There was no storm in him. And then Brian. Sonny boy Brian. That's what he said God called him. Sonny boy. Even this morning, he said there's always that combination of joy and groaning. Right? That's how he started off in 1 John. The joy and the groaning. The groaning and the joy. Right? I just want to say one word. I've never got to know Brian very well, but I admire him. I think he's one of the deepest, most honest, and transparent people I've ever heard speak. Thank you, Brian, for being you. And then there was Bill Bauer. He got up to talk. He told about how he had friends and they all knew the doctrine. And some of them told him that you should never try to get up here. You know, experience is not the thing. Doctrine, that's the thing. Right? Because there are those. There are those. There's a lot of them in evangelical Christianity who are going to tell you, no, you don't want to go up there. That's a scary place. That'll get you off into all kinds of strange things. So you don't want to go above that line. And Bill said he had friends that told him that. But what did Bill read to us? 2 Corinthians 12:9, where Paul says, I'm well content with weaknesses and insults, distresses, persecutions, difficulties, for Christ's sake. For Christ's sake. This conference, maybe you've never seen it put together. Maybe you've never seen that there's a foundational level of thought process, but there's the experiential level. This conference is geared toward the experiential level. But if you don't have your foundation, you can get screwy up here. You see, man-made religion is always looking for a way out of this. Man-made religion is looking for a way out of this. They got all kinds of deliverance ministries. They're going to deliver you from that. I mean, we all want to avoid that sometimes, right? But often we get the same response as Paul got. My grace is sufficient for you. When Paul had his thorn in the flesh, you all know the story. This is the way to that. The negative precedes the positive. The sorrow lets us appreciate the joy. The weakness causes us to recognize his strength. That's Christian life. It was for Joseph. It was for Job. Job went through all that he went through. And what does he say? No purpose of thine can be thwarted. Job 42:2. Jesus. Flogged, mocked, repudiated, ostracized. learned obedience through the things that he suffered. Paul's thorn in the flesh. I'm quite willing to be weak, that God's strength might be manifest. So what's the this in your life right now? It's always a process, but it's always different. That's why you come to a conference like this and you hear the speakers talking about the experiential process. I mean, you listen to Brian Coatney. Can you systematize Brian Coatney's teaching? No. It cannot be systematized in nice little logical categories at all. Why? Because it's the spontaneous life of Jesus for every individual, unique in every individual, and unique every day. And so he's just sharing spontaneously. Yep, that's the process. That's beautiful. But it's backwards to everything the world thinks. As I said yesterday, some people think that you can go out and you can logic someone into the Christian faith. Yes, you start with an ultimate incongruity that leads to an absolute paradox with indefinite tension, requiring an unfathomable inclusion to participate in the incomprehensible absurdity. Yeah. The natural man doesn't understand spiritual things. We have to allow for the mystery of God at work in our lives. And it's unique for every one of us, and I can't give you any procedures, and I can't give you any techniques, and I can't say, do it this way, and you'll have worked out the process. It's Him. It's just Him. Always taking you to Him that He might be glorified. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for just a diagram that lets us, some of us, sort it out in our minds to see what your objective is. To work yourself out through us and as us, unto your own glory. We thank you, Father, for Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.